Thus I have heard. At one time, the Blessed One was dwelling in the royal domain of Vulture Peak Mountain with a great gathering of monks and a great assembly of bodhisattvas. At that time, the Blessed One was absorbed in the samadhi of the many aspects of phenomena called profound appearance. At the same time, Noble Avalokiteshvara, the Bodhisattva Mahasattva, looking at the practice of the profound perfection of wisdom, saw the five skandhas and their natural emptiness. Then, through the power of the Buddha, Venerable Shariputra said to the Noble Avalokiteshvara Bodhisattva Mahasattva, "How should a son of the lineage trained who wishes to follow the practice of the profound perfection of wisdom?" Thus he spoke, and the Noble Avalokiteshvara Bodhisattva Mahasattva answered the Venerable Shariputra with these words, "Shariputra, those men and women of the lineage who wish to follow the practice of the profound perfection of wisdom should look at it like this. The five skandhas should be seen purely in their natural emptiness. Form is empty. Emptiness is form. Emptiness is not other than form. Form also is not other than emptiness. In the same way, feeling, recognition, compositional factors, and consciousness are empty. Shariputra, like this, all phenomena are emptiness, and having no characteristics, they are unborn and unceasing. They are not impure or pure. They neither decrease nor increase. Therefore, Shariputra, in emptiness there is no form, no feeling, no recognition, no compositional factors, no consciousness, no eye, no ear, no nose, no tongue, no body, no mind, no appearance, no sound, no smell, no taste, no sensation, no phenomena. There is no quality of sight and so on, until no quality of mind and no quality of mental consciousness. There is no ignorance and no exhaustion of ignorance, and so on up to no old age and death, and no exhaustion of old age and death. In the same way, there is no suffering, no origin, no ending, and no path. No wisdom, no attainment, and no non-attainment. Therefore, Shariputra, Since there is no attainment, bodhisattvas rely on and abide by means of the profound, the perfection of wisdom. And since their minds have no obscurations, they have no fear. Transcending falsity, they attain nirvana. All the Buddhas who dwell in the three times have relied upon the perfection of wisdom, and have become true and complete Buddhas of unsurpassable, perfect, and complete enlightenment. Therefore, the mantra of the profound perfection of wisdom, the mantra of insight, the unsurpassed mantra, the unequaled mantra, the mantra which calms all suffering should be known as truth, for it is not deceptive. The mantra of the perfection of wisdom is proclaimed. Teyata om gate gate paragate parasangate bodhi soha. Shariputra. This is how a bodhisattva mahasattva should train in the profound perfection of wisdom. Then the Blessed One arose from that samadhi and said to the bodhisattva mahasattva, noble Avalokiteshvara, that he had spoken well. Well done, well done, O son of the lineage, it is so. O son of the lineage, since it is just so, the profound perfection of wisdom should be practiced just as you have taught, and the Tathagatas will also rejoice. When the Blessed One had said this, the Venerable Sharadvati Putra and Noble Avalokiteshvara Bodhisattva Mahasattva and the entire gathering, as well as worldly beings, gods, humans, asuras, and gandharvas, rejoiced and praised the words of the Blessed One.
So as usual, cultivating appropriate motivation should be done prior to one's receiving of the teachings, and then this will be followed by the dedicating your merits after the teachings. So those two are known as two actions from the beginning, two actions in the head. Beginning and at the end. So this is a tradition of receiving the teachings on importance of cultivating appropriate motivations prior to one's receiving of the teachings, and having received the teachings and dedicating one's merits towards the enlightened achievement of one's own enlightenment, that of others as
언젠당아서 가르치기 위해서는 소설을 좋아하고 하이나 딱 간증 가서 긴 데뷔된 로아 대화지 되고에 세대로 왔던 너디나 데뷔된 되고에
So the purpose of receiving the teachings, if we were to ask question to ourselves, what is the purpose of receiving the teachings of the Dhamma? So the purpose of receiving the teachings of the Dhamma is to fulfill one's own wish, or fulfill the purpose, one's purposes.
오늘 데뷔된 가르두고에서는 아니 센데는 좋아심한 편지기 대지 준비된다 대한테
So what is one's own purpose here? One's own purpose does not really refer to fame or name or accumulation of wealth and so forth, but the purpose is to achieve everlasting happiness of this life and that of this life as well as the life in the future life.
대지 생인데 라신 인가라 거에 센디신 인가라 거에 생인데 데려왔다 된
The happiness is needed for both oneself and other beings, and this is also needed to this life and as well as the future life. So how can we achieve those purposes? In order to accomplish those purposes, we need to accumulate a cause that give rise to the fruition, which is the happiness. So it is therefore, in order to accumulate a cause for this happiness, imagining yourself being in the presence of the Buddha and the lineage gurus of the Lam Rim. In a way that when you are receiving the teachings, you should have special feelings. You should come to receive the teachings with the special feelings. The feelings of being oneself as a very, acutely yield person, in other words, a very serious patient who are seeking to undergo an urgent treatment. So this is the kind of feeling that you should have.
Karasana roa ngasun chiche na ngasun nepa mare debore se la gure da nangshin ngime ina nepa zada la gura tapen zada du kati shiha kwasa mare la di nepa den zada roa.
So normally, we don't think that we are a patient, because we say, I'm healthy and I have no problem at all. But if you really look at the reality of our life, there's no sudden that when we will be passed away, when we will pass away. There's no certainty of our, existence, not of our life. So therefore, since we are almost in the jaw of death, lord of death, don't we think that we are really a seriously ill person, or we are really a serious patient? So this is the feeling that we should have when we are receiving the teachings, that being oneself, considering oneself as a being a really seriously ill patient, and seeking a very skilled physicians who could treat us and alleviate us from the sufferings, the painful suffering, the pains and sufferings. So with this kind of feeling within oneself, will then take some time to meditate.
Mm.
3 to 4 minutes. Mm. With these motivations, the teachings that we are receiving as the Lam Rim Chenmo. So Lam Rim Chenmo, the teaching that we are receiving is and the condensation of entire teachings of the Buddha. In other words, it encapsulates the entire teachings of the Buddha.
Teaching Shetra Dhanayare, Lam Rim Tendri Jiru Rungo Yundi, any Zambilin Ji Sanji Ji Sungra Tata Gicho Tong Du Se Shiro, Sungji Dhan Do.
So we have a saying, in Tibetan. So when you open the text of Lam Rim Chenmo, it actually sheds the entire teachings of the Buddha.
This song in the career is saying, you know, that Raniki, Yonso Zuba, the Kuji Tin, Lord Punchy Ding, you know, Jason Tada, you turn that Kanga Lord Punchy Shower.
So if you are a racist, you know, practitioner of the Lam Rim, then right from the beginning, you will look at and look at those, you know, the outlines. Mm-hmm. You will see how, you know, beautifully that actually condensing the entire teachings of the Buddha, encapsulating entire teachings of the Buddha within this Lam Rim Chenmo. So then also when one is engaging in the practice of the Lam Rim Chenmo, it is also important to really to know the backgrounds of those great practitioners of the past, the Lam Rim Chenmo. But because if you know the backgrounds or the, you know, the brief biographies of those, you know, past practitioners of the Lam Rim Chenmo, which will really encourage you to engage in the practice of the Lam Rim. So, since, as I mentioned earlier, that Lam Rim, when you open the text of the Lam Rim, it actually shakes the teachings of the Buddha. Since this shakes the teachings of the Buddha, then if you are able to, remember the past practitioners of the Lam Rim, if you are able to remember that, then suddenly this will again shake the mind of all the Buddhas.
So
the individual who gave these teachings of the Lam Rim Chenmo is not like an ordinary person like ourselves. In fact, he or she who taught this Lam Rim Chenmo is actually eliminated their ignorance, free from ignorance or the free from mental obstructions, and gain this the complete state of enlightenment. So with the teachings that he or she has given is not just by intellectual, you know, explanations. He has not given intellectual explanation, but rather experiential explanations, the experience that he or she has gained. So therefore, if you look at the Lam Rim itself and try to really focus on Lam Rim and practice seriously, then you will see, you will have a special feelings, not just having intellectual understanding of that the meaning of the text, but it gives you some kind of, insight.
Lari chenye jebi gola ini chenye 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 na ini sanje ki sonro tanchi ta sanje changju sema na ji sonro tanchi gyujo tango re seye de na ini de sonbo bi chubi tamba kanga tu tsewa chenbi gona rani le nyebo yungo re seye de ini saje tombo nyeba ni de kuwa len to gore.
So when receiving the teachings of the Lam Rim, think about the teaching who gave this. Who gave these teachings of the Lam Rim? Who actually composed this Lam Rim? Has a very equal compassion towards all other sentient beings, and who is unconditional compassion towards all other sentient beings. And someone who has that kind of intention has given these teachings. So therefore, we should value this and then think about how wonderful it would be if we can really engage in this study and understand the meanings and follow the practicing of this Lam Rim Chenmo. When we go through this, you know, this will again, you know, covers the first two headings or the first two outlines of the Lam Rim Chenmo. Did you feel that it covers? So then the next will be the how to listen to the teachings of the Dhamma. So we are in the chapter of the middling scope, dealing with the middling scope, under the headings of the 12 factors of dependent arising. So, if we were to ask the question to ourselves, what is the main objective of the middling practitioners? So then the answer to this question is, the main objective of the middling practitioner is to gain liberations. The liberation or the moksha is the you know primary object of the middling scope practitioner. So speaking about liberations, so what is liberation? Liberated from what? So here the liberation or liberation from samsaric existence. We are unable to free ourselves from this cyclic existence or the samsara. It's because we haven't been able to cultivate a disenchantment towards cyclic existence or the samsara. It is that which really binds us within the samsara existence. So now, in order to cultivate a genuine renunciation, renunciation from samsara, one then goes through this teachings of 12 links of dependent originations or the 12 factors of dependent arising. So why we are, you know, studying and receiving the teachings on karma and the 12 links of dependent originations is because up until now we have we have too much attachment towards secular existence. And it is because we consider those worldly happiness as the ultimate state of happiness. And we are unable to detach ourselves from the worldly happiness. It is due to this strong attachment towards the worldly happiness that binds us within this cyclic existence. So it is to free ourselves from that kind of attachment, we need to know about the karma and the dependent arisings, dependent originations.
Mm-hmm.
So now when we're speaking, when we speak about the karma and dependent originations, karma, when we think about the karma and dependent originations, we should not think about, elsewhere. We should not, look outward, outside to find the karma and dependent originations, but try to look at ourselves. What kind of situation that we have, and so look at ourselves and see your own situations and understand the reality of your own situations will really enables you to appreciate the law of cause and effect and dependent originations, troublings of dependent originations. So why we have to look at ourselves is now the reason why we have to look at ourselves and think of ourselves when we speak about practicing the dependent originations. It's right from the beginning of the turblings of dependent originations. Ignorance is the first, right? Ignorance comes first. So then ask the question yourself, is that kind of ignorance that am I possessing this kind of ignorance within me? So then we shouldn't have any kind of doubt of not having this, ignorance within us, because let alone the actual nature of reality, we're not talking about emptiness, but even the, conventional, phenomena. There are many and numerous conventional phenomena that we do not know. That actually indicates that ignorance is the one that actually dominates your mind. So if you were to think ourselves, since we are remaining under the control of this ignorance, so how that makes sense to us is now, if you really think of yourself, what you know and what you do not know. So your knowledge, or our knowledge as ordinary beings, our knowledge is weaker than the small lamp of an infinite darkness. So therefore, our knowledge is something that is really minor. It is something very weak. So the things that we do not know is infinite. It cannot be fathomed. So let alone, understanding the reality of others, other phenomena. It is, we don't even know the reality of ourselves, our own ultimate state of nature.
So
So then we may say that, oh, I know myself. You know, I know, you know, I'm walking. I know I'm talking. I know I'm doing something. And then another question may raise here is, then when you say that I know I'm doing something, and I know I'm walking, and I know I'm eating, and so forth, what kind of I that you are really identifying here?
Te chorang ye denba re sro in ngai ngwa na gu do nga chog na gu do ngi ge zu po se la gu do te ti ye nga ti cha cha chen ro kar sa gu da cha hi ro ji lu ma do cha chen ngun jin zhe te gu ma do ro cha hi ro ji ma
it is true that we know that we are walking, we know that we are sick, we know that we are eating, and we know we are sitting, we are, you know, we are coming, going, and so forth. But then, when we speak about that I know and I'm walking and I'm eating as a one part of your attributes, in other words. It is one part of it's a one part of yourself, but you are unable to identify yourself, the actual you or actual I.
chera ra jing pena ni phombo se de ro ni phombo ngai phombo se ni de cha shi ji sha da ngai phombo de be de la ro de ro cha shi se son de cha chen de ge ma de so ba de ge ma ro
ni phombo se de
ngai phombo se ni chera gi ji do do ye bi son jing gen ji ge do as de ta ji ji cha da as lo da be la ro
so then think about the my aggregates or in other words my physical body here you say and the pungbo in the Tibetan term, which means the aggregates, my aggregates. So when we speak about the my aggregates, we have an idea of having that aggregate. It exists somewhere that can be pinpointed. But if you analyze very carefully, and the aggregate that you always think of that can be findable, that can be pinpointed, will become unfindable.
Tangye mungbo me shiro, tanga su tenyi da, pene nga tsu tsu mari ba shi yodi nga nga su zi ngan zin shu che bi jen ne, ne le sa gri se di kya chit kogoro wa, nga se yi di.
Here, we're speaking about the ignorance, right? So, ignorance here referring to the ignorance of grasping at self. So it is this grasping itself that enables us to engage in the actions. Then actions will become a karma, which perpetuates our, you know, life of cyclic existence.
Na se de shiwe di na gabo na chibo ni se chigi ni soso ron la dopa shu chambo chile. Jien se di ni tete tele shu chunga chi. Yapochine shuchung del min betty yawato echi loti sugi thomas sugi leka chen yorsan nganjin sing de
so we have an innate sort of feeling that when speaking about I so we think of the I should be happy I should be you know better than others and this kind of innate feeling is within us and when speaking about others we become careless about others. We have not much feeling towards others. In worst case, we even have a sort of aversion towards others and so forth. So this is innate part of our mind at this point. So then, isn't that I doesn't exist then? Why should we really think that grasping at self or grasping at I is something that is not right?
That's it, that's it. So samba na hingi nga chi yon me na no ba ro.
So then you can examine yourself. Is that I really exist as you think that really exists? Is that I really exist as it appears to you, as it appears to you.
Ane, ngatsu tatubi ngasi kandichi yorisa sona, pombo la tso zang na,
So then if you, you know, analyze very carefully, I is not other than mere, mere imputed by our term and conceptions. If you really think carefully, it will become evident to you that or self or I or any other phenomena does not exist completely by its own side. Its very existence is mere imputational, mere imputed by conception and the term. So if we were to try to find ourselves, find I or self within our psychophysical aggregates and teasing out all those, you know, parts of our, you know, aggregates, and then finally you will be reached to the most subtle substance. So then even that substance, the most subtle substance of I, is not independently existence. It does not really exist by its own side. The very existence of that particular substance is dependent upon others. In brief, if we were to analyze carefully, there is no such I could be found within our psychophysical aggregates. Although that such I does not exist, we tend to have too much attachment towards this I, and with this we generate attachment and aversion. That then leads to the actions which give rise to the accumulation of karma that binds us within this unenlightened existence. So all of this coming into being because of ignorance. So then, what kind of ignorance that really binds us, that really enables us to, that really prevents us to know yourself and enables us to engaging in the actions that are negative and accumulate negative karmas which perpetuates the rebirth within the cyclic existence, is the ignorance that we are speaking about. The ignorance pertaining to the law of cause and effect first, and then ignorance, pertaining to the ultimate nature of reality. Yes, there are the actions that we undertake out of ignorance, without knowing it. We accumulate a lot of karmas. But then there are other kind of actions that we willingly and we are knowingly that is not appropriate. We are still engaging in that kind of actions.
Tamidini, Gokotongi, you want to draw in Sane, and the Laka Kadichiana Chirangi, tell a tent the watching him and do that. In Jimmy Dancing, he judged the Chego, said.
So it is because why we even knowingly that we're engaging in that, if by knowing that this is the kind of accent that I should not be engaged in, but still we are habituated to engaging in these actions, is because of the self-grasping mind. It is underlying cause of giving rise to that kind of, attachment towards oneself and one's own actions and so forth, is the grasping at self or grasping at of me and I.
Yellow,
Niba tendi chung yu gune sambala shi la chula, yala shi ki yawada, yala ki tuwada. Marcia, di duji gile dara reshe rumshi, dara reshe. Tingi taa kip shi odi doi.
Jilo shi
rumshi. So, here we are in the second of the 12 factors of the dependent origins. It's page 316. Compositional activity. So compositional activity is karma. There are two kinds of karma, non-meritorious karma, which impels miserable rebirth, and the meritorious karma, which impels happy rebirths. So everything that we experience, everything that happens are coming into being due to one's karma. So there are many different kinds of karma, but here we are focusing on the karma that give rise to a future rebirth. This is the karma that we are talking about. We are focusing on. So we talked about two kinds of ignorance earlier, the ignorance pertaining to law of cause and effect and ignorance pertaining to ultimate nature of reality. So it is due to the ignorance pertaining to karma, one accumulates a cause that gives rise to rebirth in the law realms.
So if you
look at ourselves, how this, with not knowing the law of cause and effect that give rise to the law of rebirth within the law realm, is because without knowing the law and cause, law of cause and effect, and without having a genuine appreciation to law of cause and effect, then one engages in all kind of actions, virtuous and non-virtuous, without knowing. So mostly engaging in the non-virtuous actions, and then non-virtuous actions will then cause oneself to take rebirth within the law realms.
So then
there's another type of beings who appreciates law of cause and effect, who are very careful with their actions and not engaging in negative actions and trying their best to engaging in the positive actions. And then that too is again is said to be remaining under the influence of the ignorance, with the ignorance pertaining to ultimate nature of reality. So this compositional activity is the one that really projects us in the future rebirths. In other words, in a literal translation to this is throwing us, throwing karma, in other words. Mm-hmm. It also says penjigile, which means that actually throw us into a sudden rebirth. So this, the second dependent originations, which is a compositional activity, is has a three kinds of activities that we talked about, during last teachings, was three kinds of karma or three kinds of actions. The meritorious karma, which give rise to the to rebirth within the fortunate realms, and the non-meritorious actions, which give rise to the rebirth in the lower realms, and then there's indeterminate karma. Thank you, which give rise to the rebirth in the heightened state of rebirth, which is the devil realms, heightened state of devil realms.
Tang so kong ka se ro kong song yo ro zu kong zu mian kong de kong kong song je ro le song kong song da je dang de le gi da ran kong ke che de ma de de ne ji dang yu da kong de ka se ro kong song yo ro la da je dang de ke che re da.
So in general there are three kinds of existence realms here, the desire realms, form realms, and formless realms. So we were in the desire realms at this point. So then there are two other realms, form realms and the formless realms. So we as ordinary beings, our rebirths are pretty sudden within those three realms. Meritorious karma, which give rise to the rebirth in the desire realms, and also the desire realm within the human realms, and also the devil realms. So if you wanted to, really to have a precise understanding of this karma, then you should identify the three realms first. Desire realms, form realms, and formless realms. Then try to identify the three kinds of karma, meritorious karma, non-meritorious karma, and then indeterminate karma. So if you are able to differentiate those, along with the identification of those three realms, then you will know what kind of karma will throw you in sudden rebirths, and what kind of karma throw you another rebirth, and so forth.
Mm-hmm. Deconanino mobi mariba il ten lessane, any dendrole chigudus carina, say he to undergo any lancer, the net on the shale.
So then the, you can ask the question to yourself that how does, you know, meritorious karma will give rise to the rebirth within the in the high realms, and how does non-meritorious karma will give rise to rebirth within the lower realms and so forth. So though by reflection upon those, you know, three kinds of karma and the realms, this should have a, this should actually give you a, some kind of idea that how can you really be free yourself from not being under the domination, under the control of those three kinds of karma. So it's just like you're in the business field, that you wanted to do some kind of business by hoping of having some profit out of it. So similarly, if you wanted to know about the karma, so that you want to get out of yourself from not remaining under the control of karma. So the, with this, the second, you know, out of the 12 dependent arisings, the second, which is composition and activity, is completed. So then we talked about two kinds of ignorance. One is ignorance that says is ignorance pertaining to law of cause and effect, and then another one is ignorance pertaining to ultimate nature of reality. So the ignorance pertaining to law of cause and effect, that doesn't really contradicts the ultimate nature of reality, right? So it is only the ignorance that pertaining to the ultimate nature of reality which contradicts the actual nature of reality.
You know, lendel mo bi mariba da te khona ni mo bi mariba ni sana cha da na kar sa cha shu de lendel de ta chi cha yin la ro da me le ta tu ni le sa ro tu ni le lendel jin de wa de cha ye ro de se de te khona ni mo bi mariba gi che sha na lendel mo bi mariba de yong ko de la ai na ya cha ra cha na da da me de bi so ni chi
so here now that the two ignorance, ignorance pertaining to karma and ignorance pertaining to ultimate nature of reality. So if we were to talk about the actual object of those two, one is the karma and one is ultimate nature of reality. It says, according to the text, the karma is more, much more subtler than the ultimate nature of reality. In other words, even emptiness. So therefore, it is not possible for us as ordinary beings can have a precise ascertainment of law and law of cause and effect, or precise understanding of karma.
So
So it says the letter is further divided into two types: meritorious karma, which impels happy rebirth into the desired realms, and invariable karma, which impels happy rebirth into the higher deity realms. So we see that two kinds of even meritorious, the meritorious karma is divided into two. So then the next is the consciousness, right? And in the sutra, the Buddha speaks about the six types of consciousness. Nonetheless, there are principal consciousness is the fundamental consciousness according to those who assert that such a consciousness exists, or the mental consciousness according to those who do not assert this. Further, you become entangled in and accumulate non-virtuous karma through your ignorance of the fact that you are suffering of the pain arises from non-virtues. This latent karmic process propensities infuse your consciousness, the consciousness of the lifetime in which this happens, in the consciousness of the causal period, while that which enters the rebirth rebirth place in the miserable realm in the future and in dependence on the causal period consciousness is the consciousness of the effect period. Mm-hmm. So we'll take a break here.
Sanje shendo mende bewa ye Rogu nanda shenla shubha yo Yedan guru ra Mide naga nayan daya mi Che ante che Ante che, ta nga su te che Ta che dan yin de karsa Na shi che tenri sen la su na
So when it comes to the consciousness, so the dependent originations of consciousness, there are two kinds of consciousness it is identified, the causal consciousness and the resultant consciousness. So, Trimchi said it's pretty clear in the text itself. So let's summarize this chapter of consciousness. So we read through this, and now here, what is meant by the causal consciousness here? For instance, at this point, if I engage in certain actions and accumulate karma, and the karma that I have accumulated is imprints and leaves a latency within my current consciousness. And that particular current consciousness that serves as a basis for the latency that left by the karmic actions is said to be the consciousness is said to be the causal consciousness. So again here it is important to understand that when we speak about the consciousness, we're not speaking about the in a sense consciousness. We're speaking about the mental consciousness. Mental consciousness is the one that that you know transcends from one life to another. It is the one that actually travels from one life to another. So here, this is we do not accept the mind basis of all. In other words, so here, if you look at the consciousness under the line of consciousness, it, nonetheless. Here are the principal consciousness. It's a fundamental consciousness. This is asserted by the mind only school. Mm-hmm. And for us, we are according to the Madhyamaka's standpoint. We do not assert the fundamental consciousness or mm-hmm. the mind basis of all. Sometimes it's also translated as. So we are talking about here only the mental consciousness. So we may find some time, you know, certain explanations according to other philosophical tenets such as in a mind only and so forth. But overall here in the main, you know, the teachings or the subject matter of this particular text is really based on the standpoint of Madhyamaka Prasangika. So therefore, here the consciousness, here out of those 12 links of Dependent Originations, the third link, which is consciousness. Consciousness here really refers to the mental consciousness. So then here, the consciousness of, we talked about the consciousness of the causal period or the causal consciousness. And then there is a consciousness, what we call the effect period. So it is the consciousness, the effect, the consciousness of the effect period is referring to the consciousness of the individual who just entered into the mother's womb. The consciousness of that individual is said to be It's pretty clear here. There's two kinds of consciousness, right? Consciousness, the consciousness of the causal period and consciousness of the effect period, or in other words, the resultant period. So now here, this 12 links of different originations, it's not simply sufficient to just receive the teachings at one time and expecting that we can we know the detail of the 12 links of Dependent Originations. This is not going to happen. We need to receive the teachings and listening carefully to the teacher. And then it is important for us to go back and read those 12 links of Dependent Originations and try to make sense of those 12 links of Dependent Originations. And this is how we practice, you know. We cannot practice Dharma just simply receiving teachings from the teacher, and then you don't really reflect yourself on the in the meaning of those teachings and so forth. So therefore, I would really encourage all of you to really to read through these teachings of 12 links of dependent origination, particularly that in the 12 links of dependent origination that we find in the Lam Rim Chenmo. So it is always good to go through the teachings and that you have received, and then if you keep reading this, and then even in the future that if you receive the teachings, and this is easier for us to understand.
Munegi don't get in, but don't mashiva, dewa zombie, son of the Mayovi, less a bit. Teach in Nashine, judici, Nashi, ten rich. Tell a ten, eh? Nin do account of concomi, correct. Then drone in Sansa, Nashine, and in judici, Nashi, whom the judici was.
So then the next paragraphs here we read. Likewise, due to the power of your confusion about the reality of the selflessness, you perceive happy realms to be happy, not understanding that they are actually miserable. Through such misperception, you accumulate meritorious and invariable karma. How do you pronounce this one? Invariable,
yes. Mm-hmm.
Right?
Invariable.
Yeah, invariable karma, and that and the consciousness of the lifetime in which you accumulate such karma is the consciousness of the causal period. Well, that which in dependence on this enters a happy rebirth in either the desire realms or the higher deities, deity realms, is the consciousness of the effect period.
So, Gigi Malo, Majikitus on a yellow chit, but Roa Kaya Lion reaching Agri, that the talk of Shura.
So in the monastery, when we receive the teachings on this chapter of Troubling of Divine Originations, and teacher will actually look at the text and then teach you and explain you, and then later the students individually must explained, said by, by heart, to really to examine whether you really understood the meaning of it. So this is a tradition of the monastic tradition, but this may not happen
here.
So then there are a lot of questions raised in a different mentality of the different students. Every evening or night they have a debate session. So then they have a debate based on among their classmates. They will have a debate on one particular chapter. And whatever the argument they may have during the debate time will then be again taken to the teacher. And, this is what he thought of this, and this is what he thought, and so forth. And then teacher will clarify again. And this is a way of, the very precise way of teaching, the monastic way of teaching. So.
So Ini jin ini ya yang ni rolling cegur macam tu. Topa cik sahaja langsung nyugi kecet itu kecet mesyuarat langsung topa long cegur macam ni. Teka sen alle ronglu le kuat ni cica. Ini jin ini pikir dia jin ini ceri apa doa.
So in the monastery, what they do is, you know, they will receive the teachings on one chapter, the entire chapter. And then even though they may have, at the point, they may have certain doubt and certain, you know, questions regarding the particular chapter, but they won't ask that question at that moment. They try to receive and try to just take whatever the teaching the teacher is giving, and then highlighting their, whatever the doubt they have, and then going back and then reading by himself, and then examining again the doubt that he had. Is that really, you know, why you are having a doubt about that? What kind of, why you having raising a question regarding that particular chapter and so forth? And then if reading and then reflecting and trying to think about the meaning, and if by reading and, you know, contemplating, it is still doesn't, you know, resolve, you know, your doubts and your questions, answer your questions, then this will take into the courtyard during the debate time and then have a debate with their classmates. This is how the monastic way of learning and studying the Dharma. So, in my batch, we had a classmate. We had about 60 something, you know, students, the monks, and then later there are a lot of joiners, you know, newcomers, and they joined because they already have gone through a studies in Tibet and then came to India and joined in to our class. And then there were more than 100, you know, monks in my class. Then when we go to receive the teachings, and all 100 of us did not go to the one teacher, but we divided into like 20, 30s and so forth, so we all have the same, you know, text with the same chapter, sticking on the same chapter, but receiving from the different teacher, receiving the teachings from the different teacher. So there's a minimum of 3 hours of debate every night at the monastery. And first 1.5 hours, it's a debate will take place between two people, only two individuals. So then during the first time, whatever the teachings that you have received at this particular day, during the daytime, and then you're, you know, primarily discussing on that particular chapter, the chapter that, the teaching that you have received that particular day. So then after an hour and a half, then all the different, the batch, or you could say the different classes, will have a group debate session. So then there will be two individuals who will be answering the questions, and then rest will be asking the questions. So then this will begin with first the two individuals who's actually answering the questions should summarize the particular teaching that you have received at this particular day. And based on their summary, then question will be asked by the other individuals. So then this I found is very, very helpful, because at the group discussions, and because all of them are focusing on the same chapter, same subject, and then they have a different way of understanding, you know, different way of understanding. And one explanation may not be suitable for you, the other explanation is very suitable, it really makes sense to you, and so forth. So it's a really a healthy way of, you know, studying Dhamma. So after 3 hours, then our disciplinary will leave the courtyard, and then it is up to the monks whether they still, you know, carry on their debates, or they want to leave the courtyard and go back to their, you know, home. It's entirely up to them. But then not many people will leave at that moment, because then most of the senior monks will just come and really, you know, support the lower, you know, junior, you know, monks, and when they are on the process of studying and so forth, and then coming there and then joining the discussions and then helping them to have a better understanding and so forth. So it's a really, really good way of learning. Sometimes then there will be a lot of disagreement between among the, you know, senior scholars. And then it is very interesting, the debate that you could watch at the moment, and you also learn a lot from them. Which he said that he just remembers that it's very extraordinary, you know, memory that he has. Is sometime that there are two monasteries in Sera, right? Sera J and Sera Me. And then when some are really well known, the scholars from the other Sera will come and join their, come to their courtyard to have a discussions and have a debate. And then this really, you know, goes on for hours and hours, and watching them and learning from them is something that is very, very unique. So I myself, you know, always try to stay till 11, and, you know, 11-ish, I always leave the courtyard. But there are many who stay till 12:30, because then, you know, there's again, if you go back to your, you know, your room, then you're not free. Just go back to sleep. You have again, there are responsibility to, you know, recite your whatever that root text that you have memorized, and at that particular day, you have to make sure that you remember all this, you know, the root text that you have memorized. I couldn't stay that very late. I will just go back to sleep around 12 midnight and a little bit past midnight and so forth. But there are many who are not even, you know, thinking of sleeping at that moment, and I can hear, while I'm going to bed, I can still hear them, you know, reciting their, you know, sutras and, you know, and memorizing the root text.
But
regardless of how late that you went to bed, but you'll have to get up 5 o'clock in the morning, any minutes, because the bell will be rung, and you know, as soon as you hear the bell, then you have to wake up. So it's a really, really, you know, extraordinary memory that I have about monastic life.
대기에 단지 때 당가서 가르치 당가서 소소 가르쳤잖아. 당가서 마리바 되라. 아니 마리바 통이 마리바 될 렌데 뭐 마리바 지당 아니 가서 때 코나니 메비 마리바 니도 와서 당가서게 알레 저번만 로 왔지네. 아니 대용이지.
So now what we need to think about here is now we talked about ignorance, isn't it? We talked about ignorance, and regarding ignorance there are of two kinds, right? There are of two kinds of ignorance. Ignorance of here it says a confusion. Confusion regarding confusion of reality and confusion of our karma.
That lendele mo bi mariba te ge le kar sa gu do sana ani me kar sa ngi ro che ge le de sa gu do a ten ya la chi ni le la ni me de shi che le de ge shi wo ta.
So then next we talked about the compositional activity, which is which talks about the karma. Then there are two kinds of karma, primarily the meritorious karma and non-meritorious karma.
That the konal nil mo bi mariba ge le kar sa gu sa na ge yi le da mo yo yi le da sa gu do a.
So now the ignorance that pertaining to the ultimate nature of reality, ignorance pertaining to reality, accumulates karma of meritorious karma and invariable karma. Those are the two kinds of karma accumulated by the ignorance pertaining to reality. So then whatever the karma that you have accumulated, whether you have accumulated non-veritas karma derived by the, you know, ignorance pertaining to law of cause and effect, or that you have accumulated meritorious karma derived by meritorious karma, or the invariable karma derived by ignorance pertaining to reality. Thus karma, once you have accumulated karma, the propensity of karma will be left in the mental consciousness. The mental consciousness will become a repository of your karmic latency.
Tendriki nashi je tendri tel sendri umar raji ba da sege da se de lendre ten de chebi ani sege je namba she bal da re sen ten je den che ro wa kan je lendre ka sa le je pa cha go gi ge nashi de la ani ka sa da sege de de re sege yo re sa la da.
So then also there are certain philosophical tenets that asserts the subtle consciousness that serves as a basis of the karmic latency is said to be a self or I. So this is, we're not really talking about the middle way, you know, what we call the consequential middle way, but there are other, you know, philosophical tenets that asserts as a subtle mental consciousness is a self or I. Yeah.
That told you what's one. Nashi tendri the judici nashi tendri se de pacha jasa nashi tendri, judici nashi tendri se na ami nyen nge saja mata bi nashi tela ni yala sumba nashi tendri se lagri.
So then when it comes to the consciousness, we have a consciousness of causal period, a consciousness of the effect period, or the causal consciousness, or the resultant consciousness. So those are the three, so far we have covered that the three, you know, out of 12 dependent originations, we covered three. So I hope that you have some understanding of those three. So then, name and a form is the next, the fourth Dependent Originations. So then the fourth one is a name and form. The name is the four of the five aggregates that are non-physical, feeling, discriminations, compositional factors, and consciousness. As for the fifth aggregate, fifth aggregate form, if you are reborn in the formless realm, you have no actual form, only the seed of form. Thus, the form in the term, name in the form applies to any form such as the federalized ovum that is appropriate to any situation other than the formless realm. So, as we know that we all possess five aggregates, right? So here, when we speak about the self or I, a self or I is dependent upon the five physical aggregates as a human beings. So the self or I here is again mere imputed upon, mere dependent upon this five aggregates, and that too is mere imputational. So therefore, when you read the Heart Sutra, that you say there's no feeling, no discriminations, and so on and so forth. So what it really tells you here is, now if you really go through the each and every aggregates to really to seek or self or I, then self or I cannot be found within any of those psychophysical aggregates. So here, if you look at the Heart Sutra, it says not only that you, the self is emptiness, and then even the basis of the self, that is five aggregates, are also the empty of non-inherent existence, empty of inherent existence, sorry. So then when we speak about the dependent originations is understood in terms of dependently designated, dependently existence. So speaking, then when we speak about everything that exists is dependent upon each other and dependent upon other factor, is demonstrates the reality of how things are. So in the out of those traveling to the fourth is known as the name and a form, the dependent origination of name and a form.
Karisena Kansa Chin Changel Pomba Nabo Yobi Gumemiwa Zumela Karere Suji Pombo de Yomarwala Zume Kansala.
So then here being or the self or I doesn't necessarily be dependent upon all five aggregates. If you look at the text, it's very clear because in a formless realm, there's no form aggregates. Of course, there are other aggregates, but not if there's no form aggregates, but they are depending upon other, you know, aggregates. So the basis of the name that is imputed as a person or self is the aggregates. So it's like a cup in front of me. When I impute the name cup, it's something that is the object that is in front of me is imputed name cup.
So we'll
stop here with
the
So up until now that we are you know remaining under the control of those ignorance without knowing the dependent originations. Then ask question to ourselves, are we really remaining under the control of ignorance? So we'll dedicating our, you know, merits, just as myself is remaining under the control of all ignorance, without understand, due to not understanding the troublings of dependent originations. So too, all other sentient beings are in a similar situations, remaining under the control of ignorance. So from now on, I will try my best to, untie or undo the net of this grasping itself. Of myself and other beings. And may all the Buddhists and Bodhisattvas in the Ten Directions bless me to be able to do this.
Jambi yang jin se yin jizun ni
Dembe rinpo kyun tsang nang je cho. Nyene dhubi jena nyen se cho. Rangi chijin dhubi nang je ne. Shodra tsewe changyue thakye je. Dhoye yue je mienpa se che ne. Namo yurin zin jo chi. Dhyambo shenshin chokye machyambo Chajya nyambo chibye shodene Nyeje chenpye yira chobaye Pende dede sewa sheba sho Sejin jayu mijong chenlele Ledo shangchu langje rinpe chan Tande na je ye la be de shin Ya yue zi ba rin du chung ju chi La zang zhu bi di jin zhu xie chi Ge jin si ji mu dang mu mi kun Se ra kun du ja yue ngang ba yi Na da la dang zhi wa ma ju chi Kansi te ba cho la chu 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 jin zhu la zun ba de yue ci Tu de na ju da du chu xie chi Zha xi jang su shu gun cho ju chi Mien gu zi rao de jin na ga chen le shu ju jie ba da Lo zang ting bi zhi min sa sung chi Zhu yi min si ta du nin ju chi Zha yi gu yi xin gong zu Pin dang de wa ma li jung yi ni Xin ri si wa di zin cha zo yi Xiao bi si ting ba du nin ju chi Ba yue chi ta chi ba dong Gun du zang bu de yang de jin de De da gun ji ji si ta lu chi Ge wan de da tang ji ra du ngon Du zong xi bin ja wan tang ji ji Ma wan gong la chu du ngon ba de Da jin ge yun za wan di gin chan Zong bo shi shi rao du ngon